We have plenty of guys on the street that talk about capitalists and all them things, you know.
The police is the enemy. Everywhere the white man go, he bring misery. All throughout history, look it up. Everything them ball heads touch, they fuck it up. Every government he set up, it be corrupt.
Revolution.
Published December 7, 1899, by the New York World, Roasted Alive, Maysville, Kentucky, December 6, 1899, Richard Coleman, a 20-year-old colored boy, was burned at the stake at noon today within the limits of this city, in the presence of thousands of men and hundreds of women and children. Tortures almost unbelievable were inflicted upon the wretched Negro and all the vast crowd that witnessed the agonies of the man. Not one hand was raised in humanity's behalf, nor a single voice heard in the interest of mercy. Instead, when some new torture was inflicted upon the shrieking, burning boy, the crowd cheered and cheered, the shrill voices of women and the piping tones of children sounding high above the roar of men. Not one person in the crowd wore a mask. The leader of the mob disdained the semblance of any disguise. Every act was done in the open. There was no secrecy. The population of the whole city and country for miles around, churchmen and churchwomen, professional and businessmen of eminence, people of distinguished ancestry, formed the mob, and not a single regret for the horrible tragedy can be heard the night from one end of the town to the other. Coleman was to have been tried here this morning for a crime peculiarly brutal. He had confessed to assaulting and barbarously murdering a beautiful young woman, the wife of his employer, James Lashbrook, a wealthy farmer. There was not a particle of doubt that he would have been executed according to law. It was 2 months ago today that Coleman killed Mrs. Lashbrook. He was taken to Covington and kept in jail there for safekeeping. He had been imprisoned here, he would have been lynched without delay. The authorities hoped that the public indignation would die out. Instead, it ramified, hardened, and became as fixed in the minds of thousands as any human determination could be. For weeks, members of the Lashbrook family had been silently on guard in Covington. They heard last night that Coleman was to be sent to Maysville. The news was telegraphed and spread everywhere. The Maysville jailer asked that the journey be delayed until this morning. Sheriff Perrine started from Covington for Maysville with Coleman and several assistants on the 7:30 a.m. train. The World's correspondent accompanied them. Coleman begged to be allowed to remain in Covington. He knew what he had to expect. He told the sheriff he would be horribly killed. Pleadingly, he said he didn't want any trial, that he was willing to be hanged without a trial. He was so frightened he could not walk and had to be practically lifted into the patrol wagon which carried him to the station. The members of the Lashbrook family telegraphed word of the coming and went on the same train. They kept in the background as much as possible, but rode in the smoker, where Coleman sat handcuffed to the sheriff, and never took their eyes from him. They feared some trick by the authorities and were determined to track him to any hiding place that the sheriff might have in view. Coleman saw and recognized the Lashbrooks in the car, and their quiet, determined manner paralyzed him with fear. Deputy Sheriff Robinson tried to make him talk, but when asked questions he simply shook his head. Once asked his age, he said, "About 14, I guess." Robinson said, "You told me 20. Maybe I did. I don't know," was the reply. Sheriff Perrine, while en route, was informed that a mob was awaiting the arrival of the train at the depot here, and he hastily prepared for the swearing-in of deputy sheriffs. As the train pulled slowly into the old station, the mob formed on both sides. Armed men stationed themselves at the platforms of all the cars and warned the frightened passengers to remain quiet and not to interfere. The sheriff and his assistants were strongly armed, and there was some resistance as the leaders of the mob jostled roughly against them and demands were uttered from the outer fringes of the crowds for the prisoner. Sheriff Perrine made a bold movement and started walking swiftly, but with no indications of panic, from the car. A step behind him followed the officers, with Coleman seeking to conceal himself behind the forms of his protector. As the officers proceeded, the number of the mob were constantly swelled by new arrivals, and through the downtown business streets to the courthouse they were closely followed. Hundreds of stone and other missiles were thrown, and revolvers and rifles were free displayed. The prisoner was frequently struck, and he presented a frightful appearance. Blood streamed from wounds on his face and head. At the courthouse, a mob of 2,000 men headed by James Lashbrook, the husband, had been hastily formed. The demand for the prisoner was made. Accompanied by threats from the leaders, there was a brief struggle in which weapons were hastily drawn by the officers, and then the sheriff and his assistants were overcome by force of numbers and the prisoner was pulled from them. Up through the main street of the town the mob marched, the prisoner being held by the vanguard and dragged along with the aid of ropes loosely attached to his body. He was the target of hundreds of missiles, and several times he sank half conscious to the ground while the crowd pressed forward, striking at him with clubs, sticks and whips until his head and body were scarcely recognizable. More dead than alive, he was dragged along and forced to his feet. Scores of women joined the men. High above the noise the wretch could be heard pleading for his life. The place of execution had been selected weeks ago, in accordance with all the other arranged details of the program mapped out by the leaders of the mob. The prisoner was dragged to the sapling and strapped against the tree, facing the husband of the victim. Large quantities of dry brush and larger bits of wood were piled around him, and oil was poured on the mass while he was praying loudly for speedy death. James Lashbrook, the husband of the victim, applied the first match to the brushwood. A brother of the victim struck the second match. Someone with a knife slashed at the prisoner's chest. By a sort of cruel concurrence of action on the part of the mob, not a single shot was fired. The purpose seemed to be to give the wretch the greatest possible amount and duration of torture. The lower part of his clothing was torn away, leaving him bare. As the flames grew, Coleman's horror increased, and he struggled terribly to withdraw his limbs from the encroaching fire. The shrieks of the burning Negro nerved the crowd to greater deeds of horror. One man had in his hand the same pepper box which Coleman had used to throw pepper in the eyes of Mrs. Lashbrook when he first attacked her. This man had filled the box with cayenne pepper. He stepped close to the shrieking wretch, whose eyes were almost bursting from his head with pain, and calmly threw the pepper into the eyes of the Negro. Again and again, the boy writhed and strained at the stout ropes, and his face became horribly distorted with the awfulness of the pain. But the man with the pepper box kept on deliberately shaking more pepper into his victim's eyes. At least twice, he stopped to press down the eyelids of the Negro to make sure that the pepper did its work of agony. Scores of men had pistols in their hands. The men who came in from the country had their trousers stuffed into their boots and the handles of revolvers projected outside their bootlegs. In an ecstasy of rage, one countryman, a neighbor of Mrs. Lashbrook, pulled his revolver from his bootleg as if to shoot the Negro. A dozen men pounced upon him and made him promise not to use the weapon. They did not want the Negro to die that way. It would have been too quick. Eager hands kept feeding the flames, and soon a blazing mass reached the waist of the Negro. The ropes which held the upper part of his body burned away and he toppled into the flames. Long poles were used to push him back and hold him in an upright position. Men burned themselves to catch him with their hands and hold him up, and the crowd cheered them again and again. It was thought the Negro was dead, but as he sank to a position in the flames he cried out faintly, "If you take the fire away, I want to say something. Oh, give me water." Those were the last words he uttered. The next minute he was probably dead, as his head fell forward on his chest. But the crowd was not satisfied. They kept on feeding the flames. Lashbrook, the husband of the murdered woman, stood all the time directly in front of the burning Negro, and he did not leave until the body was almost completely incinerated. Long after most of the mob went away, little children from 6 to 10 years of age carried dried grass and kindling wood and kept the fire burning all during the afternoon. Relic hunters visited the scene and carried away pieces of flesh and the Negro's teeth. Others got pieces of fingers and toes and proudly exhibit the ghastly souvenirs tonight. With tears in his eyes, James Lashbrook said to the World correspondent this afternoon, "I toughed the match to the fire that sent Coleman to his doom. I did as I thought right, and I will stand for all that may follow." Judge Wadsworth said, "I am a police judge, but for once perhaps I forgot the duties of the office. Lashbrook has my sympathy. He left my office 15 minutes before train time. We expected Coleman last night and we waited all night for him. The coroner held an inquest this evening, and rendered a verdict that Coleman came by his death at the hands of unknown persons. What was left of the body had not been removed up to this evening and was still smoldering. All that was visible was the charred skull." Several of the women who witnessed the burning said to the World correspondent tonight that they now feel as if they could walk the loneliest country road at midnight without being molested by a black man. The crime for which Coleman was burned was an awful one. He murdered the woman who had befriended him. Coleman was not only employed on the Lashbrook farm, but he had been installed as a house servant and was trusted implicitly by Mr. Lashbrook and his wife. On the day of the murder, Mr. Lashbrook was at work some distance from the house, of which Coleman was left in charge. Mrs. Lashbrook had driven to Maysville and returned, when Coleman asked her to enter the cabin to look at some work on which he had been engaged. The Negro locked the door on the inside. Mrs. Lashbrook became frightened and screamed. Coleman threw pepper in her eyes, struck her on the head and knocked her down, but did not stop her cries. He then seized a razor, cut her throat and assaulted her. He then left the room, but returning and hearing her groaning, he struck her repeatedly on the head with an axe until he was sure she was dead. Without any show of alarm or remorse, the Negro washed the blood from his hands and clothing and went to where Mr. Lashbrook was at work in the field and told him that he had better come to the house, as someone had killed his wife. Mr. Lashbrook did not take the matter seriously until Coleman insisted that his wife was dead. Even then, so great was the confidence of Mr. Lashbrook in Coleman that no thought occurred that he was the murderer. It was not until after the officers arrived that suspicion was directed against Coleman. Blood spots had been found on his clothing, but he accounted for them by saying that he had been killing chickens. That night, however, at Maysville, a partial confession was obtained, and knowing the result if the fact should become known, the officers quietly took him to Covington, Kentucky for safekeeping. Never before today was there a man burned alive by a mob in Kentucky. If Esau is not the devil, then who and where is he?
When the people learn the truth about the system, the cities will burn, and I stand firm like Shaka Zulu. These crackers can't stop you, Hulu. This is what we've been waiting for. 21st century still poor. World war they want me to kill for. What happened to the future they always predicted? With new science fiction, new things in space physics. I seen two sides, us against them. Police troops riding with 4 to 5 men. Prison business is booming. Said it is grand.